morning.
Morning. Morning.
Good morning.
That's joking. Well, I'm glad that you're here. You know, I'm really thankful for the opportunity that we're doing together. It says the church needs to be gathered people. But as you know, gathering right now is a little bit of a challenge for a lot of people. But I'm still thankful that we can be together, though. I'm glad that we can worship. And even though a lot of people are not here physically, online, we're still a church body. And we still gather together, worshiping the Lord in many different ways and avenues. So praise God for that. We have that for good news. Just a special welcome to those online. Just me. We're praying for all of you. As you know, we say it each week, but it needs to be said that our website, southeastandybaptist.org, we post all our news, all the bulletins, all the things. So we do a good job of keeping that up to date. So feel free to take a look at that. And as you know, Life and Light is still going on. Wednesday night is the children, and Thursdays is the adult class. And the times are the same, 6:30 to 7:45. So, and as you know, we take all the COVID-19 precautions that we can. So feel free to come if you can. We do have gift bags for children. For those that want to keep busy during follow along during the service, we have gift bags there in the foyer. Each gift bag has their own kid's name on it. So. Only you would be touching that bag, and each week it gets updated and cleaned and so forth. So keep that in mind. Operation Christmas Child still going on. The display case is down there. I see gifts already there, which is wonderful. I mean, there's lots of ways, as Katie's mentioned. You can give online, create a box online. As you saw, people can bring stuff here in the box and bring them over together to. Station. So keep that in mind. I think we have a few more weeks left of that, so we'll let you know before that ends. Pastor Bob.
Okay, I think next Sunday is the deadline for the shoeboxes. 22nd?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the deadline. So need to have those shoeboxes in or the materials for them by next Sunday. Well, it's so great to see you, and I'm glad that we can be here again. And for those of you who are watching, welcome. I just want to talk about some needs. We have some community needs that I want you to be aware of that we can help with. So first of all, if you take out that, notice that insert in your bulletin, it says, fill a grocery bag for a hungry family. This is for the Family Pathways Food Shelf in Cambridge. I stopped by there the other week. Our deacons from our benevolent fund gave a gift to the food pantry, and I stopped by to deliver that gift, and I got to talk to the manager there in Cambridge. And I said, so how's it going? What are your needs? And she said, well, over the last 3 months, she said, we've had 130 new families that have started to use the food shelf. And she said, and this kind of surprised me, she said, we've seen a lot more senior adults coming in or needing food. So I asked her, well, what would be some of the top things that are most needed? And so those are on your list, most needed food items. And then she said, they always have a need for personal care items that you see there. So what we'd like to ask you to do, and you who are at home, if you're watching, you can certainly participate in this, would be to fill a grocery bag and to bring your items. We're going to do this starting now through December 20th. You can bring there, you want everything brought in by that Sunday, December 20th. Which will be right before Christmas. And maybe wait, because we've got so much down there right now for Operation Christmas Child, maybe wait till not next Sunday, but the following Sunday to bring your items. So that's a huge need. Then in your bulletin, You see an announcement for our Thanksgiving worship. Our traditional service will be held again, as always, on the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, the 25th. And as we typically do, we will receive a Thanksgiving offering. And our Thanksgiving offering will go to New Pathways. That's the organization that provides emergency housing for homeless families. We participated with New Pathways here as a host site for many years. And that is still going on, and it's extremely difficult. I talked to a person there in their office this past week. She said, well, right now they have three families. They can have up to six. They have three families. And since the COVID epidemic began back in March, normally there's 13 churches. As you know, there's 13 churches. Each church takes 1 week, 1 week four times a year and provides overnight housing and a meal. Because of the pandemic, that doesn't work. That simply cannot happen. So the families that are in the program, right now there are three, have to be housed in hotels. And they are being housed in hotels. And then they have their social worker, their caseworker from New Pathways continues to work with those families individually, helping them to get the things together that they need, helping them to move towards finding housing. So that's their services are all going on. But people are being housed in hotels. That's costly. Now, they are being helped by some of the churches that are hosting people. And instead of hosting people, some of those churches are contributing money to help cover that cost. But there's a great need there. So I want to encourage us in our Thanksgiving worship on the 25th to consider making a one-time generous gift that we can give together to New Pathways to help. You think about it, what can be worse than to be a family and be homeless? What could be worse than to be a family and be homeless in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic? It's very difficult. So let's be generous, and we will receive that offering, as I said, in our service on the 25th. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Any other announcements? Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, seems like there's so many needs in the world, Lord. But Lord, you are in control of all this. And Lord, I just rest on your power and grace and mercy, and work through people and work through organizations. Help those that are in need, Lord Jesus. Touch our hearts that where you want us to work, Lord Jesus. I rely on that, Lord, because you are all-saving grace, Lord. Thank you for this time that we can worship, we can open our hearts and minds to focus on you and your glory, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Would you please take your Come and Worship insert and follow along as I read the call to worship? If you could please read in the bold print. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shield with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. From Psalms 46. Let's stand together as we worship our great Lord together through singing. Ourselves. Help us come to you with our fears and anxieties. Remind us again of who you are, our sovereign God and our loving Father. Let's bow our heads now for moments of silent confession to the Lord. Lord, we lift up our fears and anxieties to you. Lord, we put our hope in you alone. We put our trust in you. We thank you for your love to us and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let us hear the good news. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. Stand together again if you're able to as we worship the Lord through song.
Your hidden glory in creation.
worship in that powerful name. What an awesome thing it is to come and to declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, and to live in that name that is above every name. Well, we are in a time of great need, which means that our praying for one another and our praying for our community, those around us, is especially urgent right now. Perhaps you know someone who is ill. Perhaps you know some who have contracted COVID. Perhaps you know a medical worker, a healthcare worker who's on the front lines. So we need to be praying. We need to be praying, and we need to be talking. We need to be reaching out to those we know who are alone, those who are fearful, those who are isolated, especially. This morning I want to ask us to come together in prayer, and I want to mention let's be praying for those who are ill. We want to continue to pray. We mentioned Judy Zims, Green's neighbor. We want to continue to pray for Judy. She is still hospitalized, correct, Green? Continue to pray for Judy. We've asked prayer for our neighbor here, Linda, who's right behind us, Linda Hesser. Continued prayer for her and for God's help. And then I want to ask you to pray for some folks that we are missing this morning and wish they were here with us, and that is Judy and Vince. Judy has had a difficult time this past week with what appeared to be a severe migraine headache, and that's gone on for a number of days, and now thinking it may be maybe something else besides a migraine, maybe some type of a neuralgia that Judy has, but it's been extremely painful. So I'm praying for that. And then Vince texted me this morning, asked us to pray, to continue to pray for that, and also to pray for them because they believe they possibly may have been exposed to COVID. They were with one of their sons, married son, and he thinks he may have been exposed, and he's being tested today for COVID, and Ben said that he and Judy just aren't feeling quite well. So we want to bring Vince and Judy before you, before the Lord this morning, as we pray. Let's just bow together in prayer. Father, we come in our frailty, we come in our neediness. We come freely confessing our absolute dependency on you. We thank you for your care and your love and your goodness and your protection around us. We thank you also that in the midst of difficulty and suffering that we are not abandoned, that you are with us, and that you give us perspective to look beyond these present moments and these present hours of suffering. You give us a perspective that in light of what is coming, in light of where we're going to be with you, that there is nothing to compare with that. We pray for those who are hurting. We pray for those who are grieving. We think of our dear sister, Terry Elgin, and the family of Johnny Elgin. We continue to pray for them and for the touch of your healing. We pray for the touch of your comfort to them and to others who may be grieving. We also want to ask in Jesus' name for gifts of healing for those who need that touch of healing. We will pray for continued healing and strength and recovery for Judy Zims and for Glenda Hasser. And we think of our dear sister Judy, and we would ask for Judy Bennett, Father, in Jesus' name, for your touch of healing upon her. And we pray for good health. We would pray, Lord, for your help to Judy and Vince and their family in the midst of this time. And we thank you that they belong to you and they belong to us, and we are grateful. Lord, for all those who are not here today and who are watching or will be watching later, we want to pray your blessing. We want to ask for your help to the particular needs and problems that people have that are known only to you. We pray for encouragement where it is needed, for strength, for wisdom, for your comfort. And pray, Lord Jesus, that together, even though we are apart, that together as a body of believers in Christ, that we will grow in grace and in knowledge of the Lord, and that our lives will be able to reflect you and bear witness to you through this difficult time. And now, Lord, we are going to open your word. And as always, we ask you to give us ears that will hear and minds that will be open, hearts that will be tender, and move our wills in obedience to you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're continuing our series on kingdom citizenship. What does it mean to live as a citizen of the kingdom of God? And we're looking at some challenging things, some things that may present some challenges and some difficulties to us. There is an outline on the back of your worship insert if you wish to follow along. I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bible, if you're here in this room or you're at home, to turn in your Bible to the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, the fifth book of Moses, the second giving of the law. And we're going to begin there, and we're not going to read the text right now. I just want you to get to that place, and we're going to be reading in Deuteronomy chapter 10 in just a few minutes. Well, there was a little boy named Jimmy. Jimmy was in second grade. He was very inquisitive. He was always asking about questions about how things work and what does this mean and everything. And his parents got to talking one day, and they said, you know what's going to happen. One of these days, Jimmy's going to ask us, well, Mom, Dad, where do babies come from? You know, or what's the difference between boys and girls? And they wanted to be good parents, so they thought, we need to be prepared to talk to Jimmy about, the facts of life when he asks. And we want to do this in a good and helpful way. So they went and they got some books that were specifically written to parents on how to explain, the wonders of human reproduction to children. They had books and they had pamphlets with age-appropriate diagrams and pictures to be helpful. And they had all this just waiting for the day when Jimmy would ask. And one day, Jimmy came out of his room where he was playing a video game, and he came in and he sat down at the kitchen table where Mom and Dad were having coffee. And they said, Mom and Dad, I need to ask you an important question. Where did I come from? And they thought, Dad thought, aha, the day has arrived. We need to have the talk. And Mom said, well, just wait a minute. And she went over to the bookcase and she got the materials and she came to the table and she laid out the materials. And for the next half hour, Mom and Dad explained to little Jimmy the wonders of human anatomy and reproduction. And at the end of it, Jimmy just seemed a little puzzled. And his dad said to him, well, Jimmy, do you have any questions? And he said, well, yeah. He said, I wanted to know where I came from. My friend Dave said he came from Iowa. Well, we've all come from somewhere. We've all come from somewhere. And here we are now in America, and I think everybody in this room, nobody here is a first generation of arrival in America. Maybe you are. Maybe you are a first generation arrival in America. But for many of us, it goes back maybe two or three generations. And many, maybe you came, your ancestors came on the Mayflower. But the fact of the matter is, all of us came from somewhere to be here. And that's why we are here today. I want to ask you a question. When you hear the word hospitality, when you hear the word hospitality, what comes to mind? Well, I think for most of us, when we hear the word hospitality, we think about, well, hospitality is when I invite my friends or my family, or maybe people I work with, I invite my friends or my family or people that I work with or my neighbors into my house, and I entertain them. I provide some food, some beverage, and we just seek to have a good time together. And that's hospitality. And that's the way we think about it. But it may surprise you that the word hospitality, which actually is used a number of times in the New Testament, that the New Testament word for hospitality has a very different meaning. The word that is translated hospitality in our Bibles comes from a word that literally means the love of strangers. The love of strangers. So biblically, hospitality is not about entertaining our friends. Hospitality is about reaching out to strangers. Now, that whole thing of hospitality goes farther than the scope of what I'm going to look at today. And another time, we'll take a broader look at it. But it's included in what we are looking at today. The love of strangers. Think about that. That's biblical hospitality. So I want to ask us this question. How do we as kingdom citizens view those who are strangers to our land? What is our responsibility to them? How do we view those who are strangers to our land? What is our responsibility to them? Over 90 times in the Bible, we have words, which we will see in the text that we're going to read. Over 90 times in the Bible, we have words translated as strangers, foreigners, aliens, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Pastor and theologian Tim Keller, writing on this topic, points out that the Hebrew word translated in our Bibles as foreigners, strangers, or aliens, could more accurately today be translated as immigrant. Immigrant. But that's really the meaning of that. Those various words translated as aliens or strangers or foreigners, immigrant. So you see, at the heart of the biblical narrative, if you realize this, listen, you realize that at the heart of the biblical narrative, we have immigrants. We have immigrants. The biblical narrative revolves around immigrants in a very real sense. First of all, remember the man whom God called to leave his home country, Abraham. And it is from Abraham that God enters into covenant. And from that covenant comes the promises that form the basis of all the rest of the Bible, including pointing us to the Lord Jesus Christ. Abraham, this central figure in the biblical story, Abraham is called by God to leave his country, his homeland, to go into a foreign land and live there. To go into a land where he is going to be among a different people, a different culture, who speak a different language. Abraham was an immigrant. Abraham, the father of the faithful, was an immigrant. Towards the end of his life, when his wife Sarah has died, and he is wanting to procure a burial plot for her from one of the native people of the land in which he lives, in Genesis 23:4, he confesses, "I am an alien and a stranger among you. I am an immigrant." Well, you go beyond Abraham, you think of his grandson Jacob, and when Jacob and all his family, numbering some 70 people, immigrate as a family, as a large family, they immigrate to Egypt because of the famine in their land. They immigrate and they remain there. And Egypt was not necessarily hospitable at all to foreigners coming in, but they were immigrants. They were immigrants. And at first, as immigrants, they were welcomed, but as you know, in a short while, they were no longer welcomed and were enslaved. But the whole movement into Egypt is a story of immigration. Then you have them coming out. After 400 years in Egypt, you have them coming out. And then they're going into another land, a land that is strange to them, a land that they have never seen. They have never seen. Generations behind them have never seen. They're going into the land of their ancestors back into Canaan. And what are they going to be in that land but immigrants? One of the most beloved stories in our Bible is the story of Ruth and her mother-in-law, Naomi. And what is it that's at the heart of that story? What is Ruth? She is an immigrant. She has left her native land, Israel, to go into the land of Moab, a land in which she is a stranger and an alien, and she is an immigrant. And then she and her mother-in-law will journey back to Ruth's native land, Israel, and then what will Naomi be? She will be an immigrant. She will be an immigrant. And then, of course, the most immortal, the most significant immigrant or refugee in the refugees in the biblical story, the young child Jesus and his parents Mary and Martha, forced to flee Egypt, forced to flee Canaan or Israel and go into Egypt. And what will they be? They will be immigrants. They will be immigrants in a foreign land. And then there is us. And then there is us, kingdom citizens. And you know what the Apostle Peter calls us in his first letter, in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11? He says, we are aliens and strangers in this world. We are immigrants. So think about that. When you think about immigrants, realize that that's actually our identity as the people of God. Right now we are immigrants. Now, I want to raise this question. What shapes our view of immigrants today? What shapes your view of immigrants today? In 2015, the Pew Research Center, which does a lot of really widespread, very well-done surveys about religious issues, faith issues in American life, the Pew Research Center asked churchgoers, Does your religious belief shape how you view immigration? That was the question. Does your religious belief shape how you view the issue of immigration today in our country? 88% of those who responded said, my religious belief does not shape how I view immigration. Only 12% said it did. So if it's not their religious belief that shapes their view of immigration, what shapes it? Is it what you hear on the media? Is it what the politicians say? Is it what you read? Is it what your podcast person is telling you? Is your view shaped by voices in our culture more than what the word of God actually says? I thought that was a shocking thing. Only 12% said, my religious views shape how I view immigration. What shapes our view of immigrants? Our American heritage in this area, our American heritage has some very, very strong contradictions. I'm not anti-American at all. I love our country. I'm happy to be an American. But the reality is our American heritage, our American experience has some very strong contradictions. I mean, think about it like this. What is the most revered of our founding documents, actually revered around the world, is our Declaration of Independence. What are the most lofty, soaring words of that declaration? Thomas Jefferson said, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But Dr. Martin Luther King said, that is the American promise. But the contradiction. Thomas Jefferson wrote those words, all men are created equal, endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, but the man who wrote those words owned other human beings as slaves, held them as his property. They had no rights whatsoever. That's a contradiction. And the other contradiction is that we are a nation of immigrants, unless you are Native American. We are a nation of immigrants. All of us have ancestors who came from another part of the world to come here. But the contradiction in our American heritage is that although we are a nation of immigrants, periodically, not everyone, I'm certainly not making a broad brush statement, but periodically in our country, we who are a nation of immigrants become anti-immigrant. We who are a nation of immigrants become anti-immigrant, which is really a contradictory thing. And it's not new. In the 1750s, more than 20 years before the American Revolution, Benjamin Franklin was alarmed by a growing number of people who were coming to America, and he thought, we're going to represent a disproportionate number of people in Pennsylvania. And who were those aliens, those strangers that Benjamin Franklin was afraid may come and overpopulate our country? Well, they were Germans. In a book called Observations Concerning the Increase of Mankind, Franklin asked in 1751, quote, "Why should Pennsylvania, founded by the English, become a colony of aliens who will shortly be so numerous as to Germanize us instead of our Anglifying them?" Franklin went on to call these German immigrants, who were mostly farmers coming to farm in Pennsylvania, he went on to call them ignorant, stupid migrants who will never adopt our language or customs any more than they can acquire our complexions. Oh, we are a nation of contradictions. In the 1840s, there was actually a political party that was formed specifically with just one plank in its platform to oppose Irish immigration. This political party, which never elected anybody to office, but made a little stir in the 1840s, this political party was known as the Know-Nothings. That may be appropriate for other groups. But their whole thing was they opposed Irish immigration and they opposed Catholics coming into America. In the 1920s, we had for the first time in America enacted a quota system of immigration that was skewed. The 1920s quota system was skewed to allow more people to come from Western and Northern European countries and fewer people to come from Southern and Eastern European countries, and nobody denied what the objective was. The objective was to choke off the immigration of Italians and Greeks and to choke off the immigration of Jews from Eastern Europe. And so that quota system, those countries were given very, very low quotas, so very few people could come. Western European countries like Germany, France, England, the Scandinavian countries were given very high quotas that were never filled. And I can give you other examples. The question comes back to this. What shapes our view of immigrants? Well, God clearly shows us his heart. God clearly shows us his heart and what he expects of his people. So we're in Deuteronomy chapter 10. We're going to pick it up in verse 16. It's interesting, he starts off by telling his people, you need to change your heart. It's the first thing he's going to say. You need to change your heart. Verse 16, circumcise your hearts, therefore, and do not be stiff-necked any longer. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the alien, i.e. immigrant, and loves the alien, giving him food and clothing. And you are to love those who are aliens, i.e. immigrants, for you yourselves were immigrants or aliens in Egypt. Notice verse 18. What is God's heart? What is God's heart? He loves the alien, the immigrant. God says this. I love the alien. I love the immigrant. I care for them. Because they are needy, because they are vulnerable, because they are desperate people. And he says, and then what should shape the attitude of God's people towards these aliens, these immigrants? He says in verse 19, and you are to love not loathe, not disdain, not look down upon, not seek to be rid of. You are to love those who are aliens, for you yourselves were aliens, you were immigrants in Egypt. What is God's heart? God says, I love those who are among you, who are immigrants, who are strangers, who have come here for a better life. I love those, and I care for those. And by the way, you should too. Because there was a day when you were one of those. And isn't that something that as Americans we should hear? And you should too, because once upon a time, you were one of those. What does God expect? All right, turn from the book of Deuteronomy over to your left, a couple books, to the book of Leviticus. Leviticus chapter 19. I'm going to again see the heart of God. See the heart of God and see the provision of God and see what God expects. Leviticus 19. First verses 9 and 10. When you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. God wrote in the law a provision. Leave something there. Don't take everything of your produce. Don't take everything of your grain. Leave something there for the poor, and leave something there for the immigrant, the foreigner who is in your land. And that's the very provision that Ruth would claim when she comes in as an immigrant. She claims that right to go into the fields and glean from the fields, knowing that God has provided that for people like her. That God has provided that for those who are like her. And then go down to verse 33 and 34. And all again, please listen to the heart of God. When an alien, an immigrant, lives with you in your land, do not mistreat them. The alien living with you must be treated as one of your native born. Let that soak in. The native, the alien, the immigrant living among you must be treated as one of your native born. Love him as yourself again, for you were aliens in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Are you surprised? Are you surprised? Are you surprised at how strongly God words that? The alien, the immigrant living among you must be treated as one of your native born. Do not withhold from them what you would give to those who are your own native born. So what does God expect of his people and how they treat immigrants? Well, he expects justice. Verse 33, when an alien lives with you in your land, do not mistreat him. That immigrant deserves justice, not to be mistreated. That immigrant deserves being provided for because he is, by virtue of the fact of being an immigrant coming into your land as an alien and a stranger, he is a person who is very needy, so he deserves a special provision. God said he deserves a special provision to be cared for. That's there in the statement where God says, don't take everything off the field. Leave that which may be gleaned, yes, by the poor of your land, but also by the immigrant, which was what kept Ruth and Naomi alive, because God had made that provision. And then how about this? God takes it so much farther. Look at the last part of verse 34. Love him as yourself. Love him as yourself, for you were aliens in Egypt. That was God's word to his people in the Old Testament. Sounds pretty important for us to hear. What about the New Testament?
Well, in the New Testament, it's not addressed in the same way, because the purpose of the writers in the New Testament was not to provide this kind of legislation, but rather to show how kingdom citizens live. So how does Jesus address this issue? What would Jesus say to us about how we should treat the immigrant? Well, we don't have to wonder. Because in a very broad and comprehensive way, Jesus said, you can sum up all those various commandments in the law about how you are to treat other people. You can sum it all up in Matthew 22:39 in these words, love your neighbor as yourself. Your neighbor, native born? Yes. Foreign born? Yes. Immigrant? Yes. Undocumented? Yes. Because this is a person who's made in the image of God. And they're here. And it's not your responsibility to be the judge as to if they came here legally or not. That's somebody else's responsibility. That's not my job. My job is to love my neighbor as myself, which the Bible puts in very, very practical terms. Who qualifies as my neighbor? Well, Jesus addressed that. That's the point of the parable. That's the point of the parable in Luke 10, of the Good Samaritan. The point of the parable in Luke 10 with the Good Samaritan was to answer the question, who is my neighbor? It may be the person I least expect. And in fact, the twist in that story is who is the person that provides the unexpected help? It's the one who would be despised as an immigrant would be despised by many. Our Lord and Savior and King is not silent. Jesus is not silent and indifferent to how we view and respond to immigrants and to refugees. And by the way, there is an important distinction there that some of our politicians seem to be forgetting. We have been, since the end of World War II, a nation that welcomes refugees. Refugees are people who are fleeing war, dire poverty, persecution, political oppression. You need to understand that when people are admitted into the United States as refugees, they have to go through a much, much more rigorous, difficult process to come than people who are coming in just as immigrants. To be a refugee takes a lot of time. There's a lot of background investigation that takes place before people are admitted to our country as immigrants. And the sad thing is that over the last 4 years, that flow of immigration, which has historically been open to people who are fleeing war, persecution, drought, dire poverty, that flow of immigration has been strangled down to a mere trickle. In 2016, we admitted, I'm talking about refugees who go through this extensive vetting process, who have to come because they meet specific criteria. In 2016, we admitted about 100,000 refugees. In 2019, we admitted less than 22,000. And the call is to cut that number, pare that number way down. Now the question is, how do we apply our calling to love the stranger? Which is the biblical meaning of the word hospitality? How do we apply our calling to love the stranger in a time of political and cultural tension around this issue? I want to give you four things. I ask you to note these four things. First of all, what I'm saying today is not primarily about what our national policy should be. What I'm saying today is not primarily about what our national policy should be, but about how you and I, kingdom citizens, treat those who are immigrants. We do, and part of this is to say that we do, and we must recognize the tension of the legitimate need for our nation, for our country, to have secure borders, We must recognize that. At the same time, we must also balance that with being welcoming. And we can do both. We can do both. But there is a tension there. And we have to recognize that. Between, yes, we need secure borders, but we also need to be welcoming. But what I'm saying to us is not primarily about a policy issue. It's about the issue of our heart and our attitude. That's number one. Number two, to harbor prejudice, fear, and hostility towards those who come here as immigrants is sin. It is in direct contradiction to what God in His Word says should be our attitude towards those who come into our land. If it was a sin for an Israelite to disobey those commands in Deuteronomy and Leviticus, it's certainly a sin for us, because we have a greater responsibility, as Jesus said, to love our neighbor as ourselves. There is no place in the lives of kingdom citizens for prejudice, for fear, for hostility. To say of a group, an entire group, to say, we don't want your kind here. Number three, our call to live as kingdom citizenships should shape our hearts and especially shape our actions. Our call to live as kingdom citizens should shape our hearts and especially should shape our actions towards immigrants. Who am I talking about? I get it. We don't live in a community where there are a lot of immigrant people. I get that. But what about that person whom you see in the grocery store that would appear to be an immigrant? They're speaking a different language. They look differently than most people do here. What is your attitude? Are you friendly? Are you going to be open? What about the immigrant who may be in your workplace? What about the immigrant whose children are in school with your children or grandchildren? What about the immigrant who may become your neighbor? What about that? Before I get to the fourth final point, I want to ask you to turn to Matthew chapter 25. Again, I think it's so clear and it's so vital that we know the heart of God and the words of the one that we call Lord, we need here. Matthew 25. Verse 31, when the Son of Man comes in His glory and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep. He will put the sheep on His right and the goats on His left. The king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance in the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Because this is the characteristic of the people who are His. This is the characteristic of the people who are His. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger. Immigrant. And you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. What you do for the least, maybe the people that your society, your culture, your political climate considers to be the least, when you do this for the least of these, you've done it for me. And then number four, remember this, remember this, folks, we are all immigrants. We are all immigrants. We are all aliens, strangers, living in a foreign land. Our citizenship is not primarily to the United States, or if you were living in Britain, your citizenship, you're not first of all a subject of the Queen, or whatever country a Christian is found in. Our citizenship is in heaven. Our primary allegiance is there. So right now, we're all immigrants. We're all aliens in a foreign land. But while we're here, and while we're here in this land right now, we have an opportunity. You see, one of the things that immigration does, one of the things that refugees coming into our country and other people coming into our country does, you know what that does? It brings the world to our doorstep. It brings people of many languages, nations, backgrounds on our doorstep. It gives us an opportunity to share the gospel, not in a foreign mission field, but right here, right in our community, to show the love of Jesus in tangible actions, to show Christ-like love, and by the grace of God, to share the good news of the gospel. Immigration is in the plan and purpose of God, a way for the church to evangelize many people who otherwise we would never have the opportunity to evangelize. Let's remember that. May we bow together in prayer. Lord, I find it amazing that over 4,000 years ago, your word speaks to a contemporary issue, a contemporary debate. How do we respond to, how do we treat those who are aliens, strangers, who are immigrants in our midst? Do we take our lead from what the politicians are saying or from the folks we listen to on talk radio? Do we listen to the voices that want to sell fear as a product? Or do we look at people through your eyes, see them as a value and worth because they've been made in the image of God? And just as you told your ancient people Israel, do not think of yourselves better than these people, but when the alien is in your midst, love him, protect him, care for him. Lord Jesus, you told us to go and do likewise. That's what it means when you told us to love our neighbor as ourselves. Lord, I realize that this may seem something that for many of us here in this room or listening in is not maybe a front plate issue, but Lord, there are people around us who are immigrants. There are people whose lives will cross the path of our life, and how will we view them? How will we see them? Will we represent your kingdom values? Will we reach out with love and compassion as you called us to do? And will we see that when you bring the world to our doorstep, you're bringing the world to our doorstep that we may say to them, we love you with the love of Jesus Christ and we want to tell you about him. Lord, change our hearts if they need to be changed. Change our minds that we may reflect you. I pray in Jesus' name.
Let's stand together as we close, worshiping the Lord through song and encouraging our hearts to keep shining our light for the Lord.
receive the benediction. This is coming from Colossians 3:17 and Micah 6:8. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And God has shown you what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. May God bless you.